avant-garde compositional techniques in Das Alte Lied and Immortal Bach by the Norwegian composer Knut Nystedt. Please welcome Stephen Schaefer to the stage.
Knut Nystedt was one of the foremost Norwegian composers and musicians of the 20th century. From 1938 until he became blind in 2004, Nystedt composed songs, piano pieces, choral music, organ works, chamber music, operas, oratorios, and symphonic music. In addition to 181 opus numbers, he also left several large and small works without opus numbers. His original and creative approach is evident in all his works. By the 1960s, Nystedt was highly recognized as a choral composer, including the United States, where his pieces in English and Latin did especially well. His works also became popular in Europe, particularly in Germany. He then composed several works in German, including Das Alte Lied, The Old Song, and Immortal Bach, two works that are the focus of this lecture recital. There are two reasons to examine these two German choral works by Knut Nystedt. Firstly, very little in-depth research has focused on Nystedt's German choral music. Instead, researchers have focused on his English, Latin, and Norwegian choral music. For example, in 1974, Linda Krakowska-Spicher wrote a thesis discussing the harmonic and melodic style in many of Nystedt's English motets. In 1976, Martin Stahlkopf wrote a dissertation that analyzes Nystedt's a cappella choral music and discusses performance practices of his works. His conclusions were, one, Nystedt's a cappella choral music contains traditional elements that are often combined in non-traditional ways, and two, his experimental works expand the sound possibilities of the voice by combining Gregorian chant ideas with tone clusters and spoken sounds. The musical focus of his dissertation were Nystedt's English and Latin motets. In 1999, Dr. René Clausen wrote a dissertation examining the evolution of Nystedt's compositional style through an analysis of all of Nystedt's Latin-texted choral. While all the above studies provide valuable information, Nystedt's German choral works deserve more attention, hence the focus of tonight's lecture recital. The two works this evening illustrate the second reason for why they merit attention. Namely, they provide opportunities to examine Nystedt's musical innovations. Das Alte Lied, for chorus and piano, contains interesting avant-garde compositional techniques, such as compound seventh chords, choral glissandos, aleatoric choral whispering, graphic notation, and cluster chords that expand and contract. Immortal Bach, for a cappella choir, has a unique approach to harmonic language through a varied process of prolation canon. The contemporary writing and lack of in-depth scholarship regarding these two choral works makes them a worthy topic for this lecture recital. Knut Nystedt was born on September 13, 1915, in Oslo, Norway. Nystedt grew up in a very religious and musical home. His father, Robert Madsen, was an amateur violinist and directed chamber ensemble rehearsals. Throughout Nystedt's childhood, he heard the string quartets of Mozart, Beethoven, and Brahms being rehearsed and performed in the Nystedt home. At age 9, Nystedt began taking piano lessons, and at age 14, began organ lessons with Arild Sandvold at the Norwegian State Academy of Music. After some training, Nystedt joined the boys' choir, Olavsguttene, Olaf's Boys, serving as an accompanist and coloratura soprano soloist. His interests in composition, choral music, and the organ grew during his high school years when he started his own youth choir when he was just 17 years old. Nystedt read David Monrad Johansson's book on Edvard Grieg 3 times. It was at this time that he became enthralled with Romanticism and began composing. In 1931, Nystedt enrolled at the Music Conservatory in Oslo, where he studied composition with Pierre Stenberg, a Palestrina scholar, and Bjørn Brustad, a violinist and composer strongly influenced by the contemporary works of Igor Stravinsky, Bela Bartok, and Paul Hindemith. While at the conservatory, he also studied orchestral conducting with Joachim Festel. Nystedt received his organ degree in 1936 and later a conducting degree in 1943. During the years between 1940 and 1945, he made a living as a church organist and as a director of several amateur choirs and orchestras. In 1945, the Norwegian Association of Composers awarded Nystedt a grant to travel to the United States to study composition with Aaron Copland. While in America, he also studied organ with Ernest White and conducting with Robert Shaw. Nystedt returned to Norway in 1950 and founded Det Norske Solistkor, the Norwegian Soloists Choir, a 40-voice professional mixed chorus. The Norwegian Soloists Choir performed Nystedt's challenging contemporary choral music, which no other Norwegian choir had been able to do. An advanced choral ensemble was necessary to learn and perform his new and experimental compositions. Nystedt conducted the Norwegian Soloists Choir for 40 years, stepping down from the podium in 1990. At the same time, Nystedt retired as organist from the Torshov Church, where he had played every Sunday for 36 years. Due to age restrictions, he also retired as professor of choral conducting at the Oslo University. He continued composing until 2004, when his eyesight failed him. In 2014, the composer died at 99 years old. He is best remembered for his unique choral compositions that clearly define his compositional styles. Like many composers, Nystedt's compositional style can be categorized into distinct periods. Initially, Edvard Grieg was the inspiration for Nystedt's earliest compositions and first style period from 1938 to 1946, which featured his national romantic writing. The majority of his music was based on Norwegian folk tunes with romantic harmonies. During the German occupation of Norway in World War II, between 1940 and 1944, folk music increased in popularity. Nystedt cited the following works as examples of his national romantic style: Norway, My Country, Opus 15, a cantata for soloist, mixed chorus, and orchestra. Variations for organ on Norwegian folk tunes, Opus 4, and The Land of Suspense, Opus 19, a symphonic fantasy for orchestra. In addition to using vernacular texts, these works reflect the influence of his teacher, Bjørn Brustad, by incorporating neo-romantic harmonies and melodies with distinct folk elements. Shortly after World War II, Nystedt's neoclassical styles period developed between 1946 and 1958. He focused on forms and genres from the classical period. The majority of music composed in this period was instrumental, like his Concerto Grosso for strings and three trumpets, Opus 17, and Concertino for clarinet, English horn, and strings. In 1947, Nystedt was awarded a grant from the Norwegian Association of Composers to study music with Aaron Copland in the United States. While studying with Copland, Nystedt composed Symphony for Strings, Opus 26. This piece was in sonata form, however, it contained unconventional rhythms, syncopations, and small motivic fragments. During this second period, Nystedt built relationships with American choral directors such as Frank Pooler, former director of choral studies at California State University, Long Beach, and Leyland Saturin, former director of the Augsburg Choir in Minnesota. These conductors introduced Nystedt to the American choral scene at the collegiate level. Frank Pooler even traveled to Norway to encourage Norwegian composers to write sacred works in English. One of the most popular English motets composed by Nystedt was Cry Out and Shout from 1955. In the following years, American choral directors encouraged Nystedt to compose longer, more technically challenging choral works with extended choral textures and innovative timbres. In 1958, Nystedt abandoned classical forms and developed new designs, initiating his third period. In a lecture given at Oslo University in 1968, Nystedt said, quote, "I felt I had to create my own unique form in order to be able to freely express my innermost musical visions. My own ideas began to emerge on the surface. I have little faith in music which is only based on structural principles. This kind of music is often uninspired and lifeless, like a skeleton without flesh and blood." End quote. During this third period, Nystedt used the Bible as a primary source for his texts and primarily composed works for orchestra. An example of music demonstrating these new traits is The Burnt Sacrifice, Opus 36, for narrator, mixed chorus, and orchestra. Another work from this third period is The Seven Seals, Opus 46, for orchestra. The work was inspired by the Book of Revelation and reflects the misuse of atomic energy. In this composition, Nystedt uses a 12-tone series that is presented in inverted and retrograde forms. Beginning in the mid-1960s, Nystedt was attracted to new sonorities, which began a period of experimentation. Polish composer Krzysztof Penderecki and Hungarian composer György Ligeti significantly influenced Nystedt and encouraged him to further explore experimental sound elements. In his choral music from this period, Nystedt expanded his compositional techniques and experimented with new qualities produced by the human voice, including speaking, whispering, glissandi, and vocal clusters, but also by adopting frequent ostinatos and aleatoric techniques. Works from this period include De Profundis, 1964, for a cappella choir, Praise to God, 1966, for a cappella choir, as well as the two works we will perform tonight, Das Alte Lied and Immortal Bach. We will now discuss an analysis of Das Alte Lied. Das Alte Lied, the Old Song, Opus 83, for chorus and piano, was written by Nystedt in 1978 for the inauguration of the Rogaland Music Conservatory in Stavanger, Norway. The piece was inspired by a copy of the oil painting Lo Spasimo by Ambrogio Antonio Alciati, which hung in Nystedt's childhood. Alciati was an Italian painter from the early 20th century, most remembered for his portraits using impasto technique. This technique involved placing paint on the canvas in very thick layers, usually enough that the brush or knife strokes were visible. On the back of the painting was a poem by the goldsmith and admirer of Italy, Karl Kocher, which Nystedt chose as the text for Das Alte Lied. Kocher was a non-commissioned German officer who, in 1909, published the melancholy poetry collection Der Toten Schadel, The Skull. Let Not the Old Song Fade Away is a poetic interpretation of Alciati's painting, showing a reclining, dying woman while the wind takes the shape of a violinist floating above her. In other choral works, Nystedt interprets the text continuously with tone painting effects. In Das Alte Lied, however, the choir creates layers of sound with varying color and dynamic expressions to portray the melancholy atmosphere of the words. Nystedt creates sound layers in Das Alte Lied by writing simultaneous seventh chords. The Harvard Dictionary of Music defines a seventh chord as a chord formed by the addition of pitches, a third, a fifth, and a seventh above the lowest pitch or root. Such a chord can be formed on any of the seven notes in a diatonic collection. End quote. In a seventh chord, the seventh scale degree is dissonant with its root, both pitches forming either a seventh interval or, in inversion, a second. In this manner, all seventh chords have a degree of dissonance. In tonal harmony, seventh chords require resolution of the dissonant pitch or pitches. In post-tonal harmony, seventh chords have been freed of some of their former restrictions. These chords have become stable entities in themselves, with their dissonant tones not necessarily prepared or resolved. Nystedt is not the first composer to think of emancipation of dissonance. Other composers have written works that explore dissonance as a means of harmonic construction. Especially notable was Arnold Schoenberg, who broke free of conventional tonality and key in his string quartet number 2 in 1908, entering into a new age of dissonance. In Das Alte Lied, Nystedt layers multiple seventh chords simultaneously, creating striking dissonances. He achieves this by stacking them one tone at a time via major and minor second intervals. Each pitch sustains after its entrance, creating a dense, cluster-like sonority. Please see example 1. Example 1 demonstrates this layered seventh chord technique. In measure 24, the following pitches are sung in a cascading entrance: B flat, A, F, G flat, E flat, D, B natural, and C. The pitches are presented in dyads, each dyad having the quality of a minor second interval. The choir is divided into 8 voice parts at this section of the music, with the upper 4 divisions, soprano 1, alto 1, tenor 1, bass 1, forming a C half diminished seventh chord. The lower 4 voice parts, soprano 2, alto 2, tenor 2, bass 2, form a B half diminished seventh chord. The latter seventh chord does not change during this section, thereby acting as a static pedal chord. The initial seventh chord oscillates every 2 measures between C half diminished seventh chord and a fully diminished C triad. Another technique used to create avant-garde timbre is dynamic exchange. Dynamic exchange occurs when simultaneous textures interchange contrasting dynamics in a teeter-totter-like fashion. Please see example 2. Example 2 demonstrates the shifting of dynamics through the same vertical space. While the upper treble texture crescendo from pianissimo to forte, the lower bass texture decrescendo from forte to pianissimo. In this manner, the voices are treated like instruments. For one, they are not singing text, but rather simply vocalizing on a neutral O. Using this wind instrument-like effect, Nystedt creates an aural swell and decay within the soundscape. Additionally, the accompanist contributes to this shifting dynamic technique. In measure 26, the chords in the treble staff are indicated to be played at a forte dynamic, while the chords in the bass staff are indicated at a piano dynamic. In the next measure, the treble and bass staff both show opposing dynamic shifts that mirror the treble and bass vocal texture. The NAU chamber singers and accompanist will now perform example 1 and example 2.
Thank you.
whispering can be traced back to the early 20th century through the concept of Sprechstimme, the German word for speech voice. Loosely defined as words whispered or spoken on indeterminate or approximated pitches, Sprechstimme was an important technique introduced by Engelbert Humperdinck in his opera Königkinder, and later developed by Arnold Schoenberg in Pierrot Lunaire. First created for solo voice, Sprechstimme is widely used in big 20th century choral works, such as Michael Hennigan's The Creation and Igor Stravinsky's L'Histoire du Soldat. Please see example three. In example three, Nistedt couples the concept of choral whispering with a moment of aleatoric writing. Aleatory music is music in which deliberate use is made of chance or indeterminacy. The degree of leeway left to the performer may vary widely in aleatory music and is closely tied to the notational system used. From measures 67 through 70, each section of the choir is presented with the same German phrase, Das will ich ewig lauschend ausgenießen. Nistedt writes the German word flüstern above each measure, directing the singers to whisper rather than sing. This short German phrase is presented in a single repeated measure with an infinity symbol above the repeat sign. The measure is followed by a solid black line continuing through the score until the downbeat of measure 70, indicating the end of the repeated whispers. Beginning with the basses, then tenors, altos, and sopranos, singers enter successively in a stretto-like manner, one voice part at a time, while the accompanist provides strict ascending and descending major seventh intervals across the piano. The NAU chamber singers and accompanist will now perform example three. Choral glissandi in Das Alte Lied displays another avant-garde choral technique. A glissando may be defined as a continuous sliding movement from one pitch to another. In his piece Nota, Swedish composer Jan Bark uses choral glissando to arrive at a unison pitch from a tone cluster. Swedish composer Fox Raab incorporates graphic notation in his piece Rondes to show expanding vibrato, which then becomes widening glissandi. While many 20th century composers incorporate glissando for the choir, Nistedt takes this technique a bit further. Please see example four. In this example, dense clusters are formed with each successive voice entrance and begin to slide from the initial cluster down the octave and back up. The basses and tenors form a four-note set, or tetrachord, comprised of pitches F-sharp, G-sharp, A, and C. The intervals that constitute this tetrachord are 1 minor second, 1 major second, 2 minor thirds, 1 diminished fourth, and 1 tritone. The sopranos and altos also form a tetrachord comprised of pitches G-sharp, B, C-sharp, and D. The intervallic content of this chord is the same as the bass tenor tetrachord, but contains a perfect fourth instead of a diminished fourth. When all eight voice parts sing, the result is an extremely dense six-note set, or hexachord. This dense cluster chord uses glissando to slide up and down the octave before sliding up to each singer's highest possible note. The indication to slide up to the highest undetermined pitch is represented by graphic notation, in particular, an arrow pointing upward with a staccato on top of the point. Since each singer has a different highest possible pitch, the effect will vary with a different group of singers. The NAU chamber singers and accompanist will now perform example 4. That are a major or minor second interval apart, forming a sound mass rather than a chord identifiable with traditional tonal or triadic harmony. An early example of a cluster chord was used by American composer Henry Cowell in 1913. He first demonstrated clusters by using his forearm to play the piano, resulting in a large dissonant chord. A later example of tone clusters for chorus include Krzysztof Penderecki's St. Luke Passion, where clusters are produced by individual voices consecutively sustaining notated pitches. In Das Alte Lied, Nistedt demonstrates cluster chords in an experimental fashion. Here, the number of pitches increase and decrease within a continuously changing dissonant cluster. Please see example 5. Example 5 shows each entrance of clusters beginning in unison and sliding to more pitches above and below the initial note. The clusters increase to a designated maximum pitch content before decreasing the number of pitches in reverse order back to the starting note. Within a span of 2 measures, each cluster expands and contracts to and from its initial starting note. At the point of greatest density, each cluster expands into a perfect fifth, comprised of all the half steps contained therein. With each expansion, the clusters crescendo, and with each contraction, the clusters decrescendo. The cluster chords are performed in each section of the choir beginning on different starting notes, and expand or contract at different times. The altos repeat their cluster ostinato 5 times. The tenors and basses each repeat their respective cluster ostinato 4 times. The sopranos repeat theirs only 3 times. The altos, tenors, and basses each repeat their cluster ostinato 1 final time down the octave. In this passage, Nistedt creates 1 to 10 note cluster chords comprised entirely of minor seconds or half steps. The NAU chamber singers and accompanist will now perform example 5. Piano part in a choral work is most often used to support and enrich the choral sections melodically and harmonically. In Das Alte Lied, Nistedt has given the piano a mood-creating function as well as a supporting component. For the majority of this work, The sound of the piano is an extended part of the color within the choral sound. However, Nystedt occasionally strips the chorus away from the piano, demonstrating the piano's full range and unique timbre. Similar to choral glissandi, example 6 demonstrates the sliding up from one note to higher pitches. In a direction on the score, he specifically asks the pianist to perform these glissandi directly on the piano strings with their fingernail. This technique creates a brighter, more scraping sound. The accompanist will now play example 6. Within the same section of music, Nystedt writes a second avant-garde technique for the pianist. Please see example 7. The accompanist is instructed to pluck designated strings on the inside of the piano. The effect is gentler and more reminiscent of a harpsichord rather than a piano. The accompanist will now play example 7. Throughout the entire work, Nystedt shows a keen interest in sound mass and primarily expresses this compositional interest through a specific interval, the minor second, and its inversion, the major seventh. From the opening of the piece, we hear a B flat in the low bass of the piano against a B major seventh chord in the upper bass register. In example 1, we see simultaneous seventh chords being introduced through consecutive half-step entrances in the choir. At the end of this example, the piano presents two pairs of dyads, D-flat, E-flat, and C-natural, D-natural, each a half step apart. In measures 44 through 46, the piano shows a complete chromatic collection showcasing the full range of the keyboard. In example 3, while the choir whispers in aleatoric fashion, the piano undulates ascending and descending chromatic scales with successive tones a major seventh apart. Examples 4 and 5 highlight the interest in the minor second interval by presenting dense cluster-like sonorities. By using chant-like whispering, cluster chords, choral glissandi, internal glissandi, minor second intervals, and a series of plucked strings, Nystedt composed an experimental choral work that is focused on sound mass, sometimes consonant, and sometimes not. The NAU chamber singers and accompanist will now perform Das Alte Lied.
Thank you.
Nisted taught, Komm selge Ruh, come sweet death, come blessed rest, was originally a song for solo voice and basso continuo, found in Johann Sebastian Bach's Geistliche Lieder und Arien. The text is by an anonymous author. In the song, the singer wishes for death so that they may enter heaven. This melody is perhaps one of the most famous tunes that Bach ever wrote, being adapted by several composers, including Max Reger, Leopold Stokowski, Virgil Fox, and of course, Knut Nystedt. Nystedt's Immortal Bach, Opus 153b from 1988, for unaccompanied chorus, has gained wide popularity around the world. To compose this piece, Nystedt used the first eight measures of the chorale setting Komm süße Tod, Komm selge Ruh, by J.S. Bach. Out of respect for Bach, he did not change a single note. The way that Nystedt sets Bach's chorale is both simple and avant-garde. Through augmentation of the tempo and harmonic overlapping of Bach's melody and harmony, Nystedt symbolizes Bach's immortality by literally giving an impression of timelessness. The composer achieves this through a technique called prolation canon. The premise of a canon is that it is a single melodic line that can be sung starting at different times, creating harmony with itself. Nystedt takes this idea a bit further, experimenting with the prolation canon. In a prolation canon, or proportional canon, the main melody is accompanied by one or more imitations of itself that have proportional rhythmic relationships. Thus, while the voices sing or play the same melody, they do so at seemingly different speeds. Prolation canons are among the most difficult to write and are most common in the early Renaissance. Famous examples of prolation canons include the entire Missa Probationum by Johannes Ockeghem, in which each section of the Mass explores different gaps between canonic entrances and relative speeds of each voice, achieved by using two different prolations or meters. Other composers who wrote prolation canons include Josquin des Prez, Johann Sebastian Bach, and Arvo Pärt. Immortal Bach is in two parts. The first part of the piece is an eight-measure, four-part homophonic chorale that directly quotes Bach's chorale, Komm süße Tod, Komm selge Ruh. The rhythm is simple, using only quarter notes, eighth notes, and dotted half notes. Please see example 8a. In this example, Nystedt demonstrates Bach's original chorale and part one of Nystedt's composition. In this example, the vertical harmonic shifts are instantaneous and chords change almost every beat. The NAU chamber singers will now perform example 8a. The second part repeats the same melody and harmonization in part one, but now arranged into a five-part proportional canon. The rhythm is basically the same as in the first part, but sung at five different tempos. The entire ensemble divides into five smaller choirs, with each group holding the quarter note value for varied lengths. Group one sustains the quarter note value for 4 seconds, group two for 6 seconds, group three for 8 seconds, group four for 10 seconds, and group five for 12 seconds. In the strict definition, this piece is not entirely a prolation canon, but a modified process, since all groups enter simultaneously and only later begin their augmented counting. One other difference between this piece and a strict prolation canon is that Nystedt asks for each group to sustain the last chord at the end of measures 2 and 4, while the other groups arrive at the cadence. Measures 1 and 3 begin and end together while exploring various speeds of arriving at the same destination. Please see example 8b. This example shows the harmonic realization of the score in part 2. This example demonstrates the immense vertical harmonies created through the modified prolation process. Since all voice parts do not move at the same time, the original chords change at staggered moments. The NAU Chamber Singers will now perform example 8b, which shows measures 1 and 2 in Bach's original version with Nystedt's modified prolation canon. Choral music in the 20th century can be seen as an outgrowth of evolving trends. Along with breaking from tonality, composers began experimenting with various ways of setting rhythm and constructing form. This led to a reimagining of sound itself and the various possibilities that instruments and voices could achieve. Choral composers latched on to these ideas and began writing avant-garde music. With 181 opus numbers and several significant works without opus numbers, Knut Nystedt has left a great musical legacy. He was a leading avant-garde choral composer during the mid-20th century, whose music demonstrates an evolving style from neo-romantic to classic to free-form to a more avant-garde compositional style. With musical styles that were new, but at the same time anchored in tradition, he offered people a new expressive way of hearing choral music. He wrote simple and sophisticated music for organ, orchestra, various assortments of instruments, and choir. His choral music demonstrates a unique approach to sound and vocal timbre with compositional techniques such as changing cluster chords, choral glissandi, aleatoric whispering, playing inside the piano, and modified prolation canon. With this paper, I hope that more choral conductors will investigate Nystedt's music and his other works in English, Latin, and Norwegian. At this time, I'd like to briefly acknowledge a couple of people. I would first like to thank my graduate lecture recital committee, Dr. Stephen Brown, Dr. Julie Hedges Brown, and Dr. Enid Copley. They definitely deserve applause, but let's applause at the very, very end. I'm sorry, that was my cue. Thank you all three for meeting with me in person inside your office and impromptu in the hallway. Your astute edits on many of my drafts and papers, and your very strong leadership. I will continue to remember all of you as I move on next year and begin teaching. I hope to emulate your styles of teaching. I'd like to then thank my parents and siblings who are scattered around the audience for listening to lots of piano music in my early days and supporting me with paying for piano lessons and encouraging me to studying music in college and attending almost all of my recitals and choral works. Thank you, guys. I'd like to also thank my church families. I work at two churches. First Congregational Church of Flagstaff and the Peace Lutheran Church. You both provide an outlet for me to express sacred music and connect with people in the community more intimately. I'd also like to personally thank the NAU School of Music Administrative Assistant, Jennifer Saunders. This person in the School of Music works very hard and does many tasks, and all of which I've experienced very quickly, so I definitely appreciate her professionalism. I would also like to thank the NAU Choral Studies Administrative Associate, Ruth Soline. Ruth and the grad students, I would say, we are one of the backbone elements of the choral department, and she's always there to lend an ear and also sometimes to tell you a story about her oboe. I'd also like to thank the NAU Associate Director of Choral Studies, Dr. Ryan Holder. While not studying with him for too long, I actually had the opportunity to study with him in my undergrad, taking undergraduate conducting. So I'd like to thank you for the precipice of my conducting technique, Dr. Holder, and also for providing a very calming effect when things seem very stressful during the just the school year. And also thank you for giving me the opportunities to sing with sax. I'd also like to thank former master's student Gregory Chenoweth for providing me insights on how to build, program, and use InDesign software. Then I'd like to thank the auditorium staff here at Kit Recital Hall with lighting and opening of the doors and recording sounds and providing Dr. Saunders' announcement. None of this would be possible without them, so I'd like to give them some snaps immediately. Couple more people. The NAU piano technician, Aaron Sandner, providing guidance on how to deal and properly care for a piano using extended technique. Thank you, Aaron. I'd then like to thank the NAU chamber singers for their work with this unique music that we've been performing for the last couple of weeks. This music has been almost a decade dream to get to perform and teach. I've been sort of obsessed with this composer since hearing him on Pandora. Does anybody remember Pandora? yeah, so thank you for making this reality. I'll never forget it. I'd love to thank our collaborative pianist, Rebecca Prisnik. Deserves applause immediately. I also have the pleasure of knowing Rebecca since I was an undergraduate student here at NAU in the piano department. And it's a pleasure to see you here in graduate school continuing piano studies. Thank you so much for your work. I would then like to thank my graduate cohort, five individuals. Albert Lee, he's there. There he is. there he is. Ben Saunders, Ryan Phillips, Tucson. Sarah Irvin and Katie Sheridan. There you are. These five individuals have really become like a family, and I hope that many of you get to experience a tight group of friends that you can laugh with, share secrets with, get mad with, and hopefully resolve it as well. So all of those things encompass these friends, and they're all super smart and talented, and I think we're all excited to get jobs next year. Two more. I'd like to thank my housemates who are in the audience. My housemates have listened to me talk about Dr. Copley hundreds of times, in a good way. they know her very well from the stories, talk about choral music, and been very respectful, and they probably wanted to not be there and listen to it. So they've been very, very encouraging and loving, and they're just the most supportive group of people to live with, and our three dogs. And I'd lastly like to thank my boyfriend, Sam McGeehee, who I've taken many trips with and listened to a lot of weird choral music, and he's been there right next to me on the ski slopes, giving me good insights to rehearsal and supporting me musically, and of course singing in the choir. So, without further ado, the NAU Chamber Singers will now perform Immortal Bach by Knut Nystedt. Thank you for being here tonight.